early Android tablets, maybe one of the $100 ones that can barely do anything. I'd love to hear your thoughts and where you think all this is heading. Are we ready for totally cloud-based computing? I'm concerned about the bandwidth. Is that creating a new digital divide of folks that no longer is it just folks who don't have computers, but now they're required to have tablets and phones and all these internet appliances, all of which have to have broadband in order to do their thing. You have to have a broadband connection pretty darn fast to store everything. And speaking of broadband, you saw that T-Mobile now says they have the nation's largest 4G network. Of course, being very liberal with their definition of 4G. Some would say completely wrong. But then according to the ITU, what is that, International Telecommunications Union? I forget. But it's that branch of the United Nations that sets the standard for mobile standards like EVDO, Edge, all that kind of thing. Defines what makes 2G, 3G, and 4G. Well, they've said nothing that is out right now constitutes 4G. Nothing from Sprint, nothing from Verizon. All that talk about WiMAX and LTE, they're all being branded, of course, as 3G, or rather 4G. ITU says no. Only WiMAX, LTE Extreme and WiMAX Plus or WiMAX 2. Or maybe I have those backwards. One of them is 2, one of them is Extreme. Or Plus. Speeds that reach over 100 megabits per second at their peak is what they say is what's required to be 4G. So by that definition, nothing out there is 4G. So T-Mobile's kind of jumped on the bandwagon and said, well, hey, if nothing out there is 4G, you can just call anything you want 4G. We may as well call our HSPA Plus network 4G. They have a little bit of a point because right now T-Mobile's HSPA Plus network, GSM, is they're right that it gives basically, they say, 4G speeds compared to the current 4G offerings, the current offerings of WiMAX and LTE offered by folks like Clearwire and Sprint. They say it's meets or exceeds their current bandwidth, although the potential, the maximum for those technologies exceeds the theoretical maximum that HSPA Plus can extend. What is it? The peak right now of that of T-Mobile's is like 21 megabits with an average of about 5. And they're claiming they have the nation's largest 4G network already. And they're going to keep building it out. So what do you think about that? Is HSPA Plus 4G? Taking a look at what the chat room has to say right now. We have an excellent chat room that is essential to participating in this show at irc.twit.tv. You can go in there and see what folks are saying and offer suggestions to the callers and to me. So that's what I'm curious about. That's what I'd love to hear your thoughts on. Is are we ready for for totally cloud-based computing, or do we need still, you know, multi-terabyte hard drives, and do we need a lot of horsepower on our end? Can everyone immediately just say, "Yeah, I'll go to the cloud"? You know, security problems aside, and any other issues you may have, even just lack of features, are we going to suddenly have this division, at least in this country, with the folks who live in heavily broadband built-out areas who can afford to be in the cloud because they have the service offered to them versus folks who don't, who even if they had all the money in the world, couldn't get decent broadband access? It would seem to me that that would be the largest thing that would slow down a... Yeah, Matt Burley in the chat room says he's a video editor, has a 768 kilobit connection. Can't switch to the cloud. I get flyers all the time from AT&T in the mail, you know, junk mail saying, subscribe to our 768 kilobit DSL. That's crazy. Less than a megabit? I mean, that blows my mind. How could that ever have... I mean, that's like ISDN speed. So you can talk about anything like that that you'd like to talk about on Tech TalkBack. As I said, rather slow news week, nothing groundbreaking. You heard Facebook's announcements from yesterday. No Facebook phone, ever. Although I don't believe he said no to a Facebook operating system for for a phone. I don't think he said that specifically, so I don't know. But he was very clear about hardware. He says they don't sell hardware. They want to be on every mobile platform. And Mark Zuckerberg talked about the integration with Facebook and Windows Phone 7 as being a prime example of how Facebook can integrate so deeply into a phone's operating system that clearly there is no reason for them to sell their own hardware. If people, so he said some people are already calling the Windows Phone 7 the Facebook phone because it really is that deeply integrated. And they released new versions of their Facebook app for Android and for iPhone, for iOS. When asked about iPad, why they haven't developed a Facebook app yet for iPad, Zuckerberg said, "iPad's not mobile." Next question. And then he had to backtrack, and then he's like, "Well, I don't mean anything bad to the folks at Apple. We love working with them, but he said he doesn't consider the iPad a mobile device. It's too big. He said that's a computer. Well, what do you think about that? I don't really see that many folks walking around on the street carrying an iPad, but everyone's got a mobile phone in their pocket, right? And perhaps even these 7-inch tablets, like the Samsung Galaxy Tab." You look at its photos, it's more along the size of a Kindle 2, much smaller, can sort of fit in a pocket a little bit better. Maybe 7-inch tablets might become more of a mobile platform. Mark Zuckerberg says they're going to basically wait and see how that pans out, how people begin using tablets. You've got some tablet manufacturers like LG saying they're not going to start making tablets until the version of Android that is more tablet-centric. Let me throw this image out there for you, too, to get the conversational juices flowing. Because on slow news weeks like this, I love to throw out the nostalgia factor, too, where we're going and where we've been. Look at this infographic that someone made at flowtown.com. The subjective life of a computer user takes you through the Commodore VC2 and Frogger, Nintendo, NES. Is this a... I think this is very subjective because it looks like more along the lines of one man's history with computers. Oregon Trail, Macintosh Portable, Macintosh. It's very Apple-centric, although Windows 2.0 is on there. Commodore 64, Windows 95, Street Fighter Alpha, and Hotmail. Odd choices. Chat rooms, Buddy List, Palm Pilot, Dell Laptop. That's an odd choice. Again, way more Macs and more Apple products, culminating with iPad. So nostalgia computing is something that I find fun to talk about. Do you have any fond memories of technologies gone by and old computers that you just don't want to get rid of? I've got a PowerBook G4 first generation sitting at home that I probably should have sold it. But now it's like I can't even let it go because it looks like a relic. It's the very first generation of the G4s, one of the very first widescreen laptops. And certainly a lot of memories on that thing. So, what do you think about all this? 724-444-7444. Call ID 83337. Taking your calls on anything you'd like to talk about in tech. Smartphone addiction. Are you addicted to your smartphone? I think that's a little silly. I can tell you why. We can talk about the MacBook Air. I can give you my take on the MacBook Air. I got a 13-inch. I have had it for about a day or two. Been playing with it, been moving my stuff over to it, trying to make it my main machine for most things. Not for the heavy computing, like video editing. Although I did get one that could potentially do that if I were on the road and mobile and needed to do a little bit of light Final Cut. Right? Nothing too heavy. Very fast, very light. If you're curious about the MacBook Air, I can tell you all about that. One thing that's interesting is I think that the reason that one of the ways that they've clearly extended the battery life to the full 7 hours as they have, and indeed many people are getting even more than 7 hours of battery life. I got close to that already, if not over that. I don't think it's just increasing the battery power or the low power draw of the components. I think that they've also made huge strides in the scalability of the power requirements over usage, over the level of usage. You can sit and watch the little meter in the top right-hand corner go from predicting, 8-9 hours of battery time remaining to as soon as you get a download going that is using your wireless internet at full blast, or as soon as you load anything with flash, you can see that drop to 3 hours. Even with, you know, even flash that uses minimal CPU, instantly your battery life gets more than cut in half, which may help to explain why Apple has stopped shipping flash with these MacBook Airs, first models of Macs not to have flash pre-installed. Apple said, oh, well, we think it's best if users get the most recent version from Adobe. People said, oh, they're trying to kill flash. But in the case of these MacBook Airs, I have to say, the difference between landing on a page covered in flash and getting flash versus landing on a page covered in flash and getting HTML equivalents or static images or something when it detects you don't have flash, or like I do, have click to flash installed, or one of the flash blockers, it more than cuts your battery in half, even if it's not really using that much CPU, even if you're watching the meter and it's not using that much. So Apple's worried that if people start using flash on their MacBook Airs, they'll see, whoa, goodbye 7 hours of battery. Some other things do that too, playing even an H.264 native QuickTime movie full screen will cut your battery in half very, very quickly. But for doing things like reading RSS feeds, answering email, basic web browsing, yeah, you'll easily get 7 to 8 hours out of this thing. It's pretty cool. So what do you think? Have you gotten a MacBook Air? Or are you thinking about it? Or are you moving? Have you already moved everything to the iPad and you don't even care about Netflix or anything anymore? You're totally on the tablets. Let me know what you think. 724-444-7444, ID 83337. Let's take our first call here, which is from Mr. Brian Monroe from the chat room. Hey, Brian.
Hey, Eric. Good morning. Nice to talk to you this morning.
Greg, good to talk to you. How are you?
Good. Doing good. I actually just posted a link to an article a friend of mine sent to me about the flash you were just talking about a second ago. There looks like they're actually going to be improving the CPU utilization on that by the bytearray.org website. Do you see that in the chat room there?
No, my chat room actually crashed. I see it on the big monitor, but not on my local laptop here. What, so could you? What's the URL or what's the site?
It's called bytearray, bytearray.org, and there's a question mark P equals 2195 is the thing, and actually you should have that on your chat room for the talk show too, actually, if you should be able to click on the link there to put in there.
I see it, yes. Okay, let me enter that.
Excellent, yeah. I just wanted to, you know, share with some, hopefully some good, positive good news that Flash should be taking a lot less CPU utilization sometime in the near future, what they're working on. And, again, my friend that's a Flash programmer, you know, likes to tell me with some of the fun things that are kind of coming on the horizon for Adobe Flash. But I definitely think there's some, at least hopefully they're working on making it better, I'll say. So,
boy, I hope so. I'm curious, when was this posted? I don't see a date on the on this blog post.
Yeah, I'm not sure. My friend just sent this to me just the other day. So, but there's some comments looking up and down here. It's from October 2nd, October 10th. So it looks like it must have been around the beginning of October. This thing must have been posted, looks like, from what I can tell from the comments below, at the bottom.
And this is from an actual Flash developer?
Yeah, it was my friend. He actually, well, he sent me this link. I'm not sure about, you know, about this website, but he like just wanted to share with me, just let me know kind of, good news is on the horizon, let's say, anyway. So for Flash users, people using Flash products on the Mac and CPU utilization, you can see there, hopefully, if you're bringing that up right now. There you go, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You're bringing it up, yeah. You're seeing that utilization 52% down to like 8%.
Oh, wow, yeah. Look at that. It went from 234% down to 20.
Yes, exactly. And I think even the RAM utilization, also the real memory, how much you're using is 80 instead of 167. And so there's definitely definitely some work there they definitely need to be doing, and they are doing. And I'm glad to see that's happening now with Flash.
Yeah, I sure hope we see that soon. I mean, they had that GPU acceleration in the beta version of Flash 10.1, but then when the actual 10.1 official release came out, it was gone. So I really hope they bring that back.
Yeah, well, that's the thing. I remember actually was playing around with the beta version of my friend. Again, he sent me the link to that and all the Adobe Labs website, which was cool. So
cool. Well, that's good to know.
I also wanted to bring up, you were actually meant, you also mentioned about, let's see, about a couple things in the cloud storage. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, one of the points I get from my customer base, people I help work computers and whatnot, is there is definitely a concern about security, you know, where this data is. Like, oh, they're like, where's the cloud? You know, where is the data really living? And they don't really understand that, like, it goes away from the computer and then this goes to the nebulous place in the internet called the cloud, right? And then who has access? Are things secure or not secure? You know, those kind of things. And even more so, I think, really, and just recently a little thing here, my dad's Gmail account got hacked the other day because he decided to give up his username and password for his login there for some reason. I don't know why he did that, but to an Ellis Island website. And the long and the short was that some Nigerian hacker got in and erased all his contacts and was doing this letter from London. The one Leo's been talked about before, the one letter from London where they had trying to basically ask for money, people send money kind of quick and everything. And the interesting thing about the thing was that the hack actually turned out that the guy actually set up a recovery email box. It was one letter off from my dad's regular Yahoo box that he was using for their recovery, basically, right? So, you know, the average person who might see that thinks it's his mailbox, right? And so they, you know, could have been, I think they set up a PayPal account, but long and short of it is everything got recovered and it's fine. But the point about it is that, you know, the cloud stuff, as you basically get synced in with Gmail, with the contacts and the calendars and kind of get a lot synced in with your iPhones and iPads and your computers, you know, if you put all the stuff in there, you got to really be careful about how much, you know, where the security stuff is actually beefed up, let's just say there. Because the thing was is that I would think from my perspective that Google should not allow somebody in Nigeria to log in without some additional security, like, you know, questions or something like that from Nigeria, from somebody who actually set up an account in America, who's never used the account outside of America, and, you know, should have actually raised some sort of red flag, almost like the credit card companies do when you basically make your purchase online, let's say internationally the first time you might make one. You know, they might say, hey, you know, is this really you kind of thing, right?
I agree. That would be a very valuable thing for a lot of these cloud companies, including Google and Gmail and all their properties to introduce. And I've heard a lot of people suggest this as well. Offer or require an extra level of verification, an extra level of security if you've got an account that for like 2 years since its creation has never been logged in from anywhere but the United States, and all of a sudden you've got like repeated password attempts coming in from a country that is well known for hackery. You know, at that point, a flag should go up and say, well, maybe we need to ask this person over there in China or Nigeria or wherever for an additional level of security that we didn't ask the guy who logged in 10 minutes ago from his same exact IP address over the last 5 years.
Exactly. I mean, that's kind of the point I was kind of getting to, is that, you know, if we trust more stuff to the cloud, we definitely need to make sure that the services, I mean, I know Google's going into the free service and whatnot, but still it's kind of a point that if they really want people to trust them or even Komomo Me or anybody else who could say any of these services, they really need to make sure that they don't break the trust of the users, let's say, that are entrusting them with you know, contact information, which actually turned out my dad goes getting phone calls all this weekend, last weekend, from people who he hadn't talked to in a long while because they'd gotten spammed by this guy who asked for money, you know? Mm. So it just actually turned out to be kind of a good thing in some ways because he got a chance to talk to some people. But but ultimately, the thing about it was is they definitely need to be looking at security more so than just, oh, yeah, here's a login, here's a password, and we don't really worry about where you're coming from and that sort of stuff, you know. And that's definitely a problem, I'll say, you know.
Yeah, security has to be beefed up on both ends, on the provider of cloud services as well as the people using it, because the best security in the world from these cloud services is nothing if you're using the same four-letter dictionary password for everything that you've ever logged into for your entire life. So users definitely have to be a lot more diligent, not just on how they create their passwords and their questions and how they manage their own security from site to site and change it regularly, but also you know, what places they give access to, you know, be extra vigilant about sites that may be trying to phishing scams or things that might be asking for your password and logins that shouldn't be getting it.
Yes, and I want to bring that point up too, which is the fact that as things get more interlinked as far as the Facebook Connect with things like Twitter, if you want to use these single sign-on type scenarios, I kind of occurred to a little bit of that Facebook announcement the other day. Unfortunately, I had to go to work, actually, but it's that the idea that as these sites are getting more linked into each other and some of the concerns about, okay, well, if I have one log on here and use a single sign-on for everything, well, you're putting a lot of eggs in one basket that, you know, you got to make sure there's, you know, you have really good security there with that single sign-on, because once somebody gets that one sign-on, they other authorized websites can get in there and get into other stuff, and it becomes a big, huge problem. So I guess that's a concern I have myself anyways about, oh, yeah, you, like say you let Twitter be your login or Facebook be your login, or I guess with Google they do OAuth or whatever, but it's the concern that, yeah, again, if you're letting only one service host that, they better take security sign-on security seriously, otherwise you've got some real problems. Because it's not going to be the other sites that are a problem. It's actually the main host site that actually you single sign off of, let's say Facebook, for example.
You know what's funny? This just occurred to me. Here we've got all these touch-based devices. We're typing with our fingers and we're swiping to unlock with our thumbs and everything. Why have none of these devices yet implemented a password system that is based on your thumbprint or any fingerprint, you know? I get that maybe the capacitive touch screens aren't exactly the kind of photographic or sensitive to read a thumbprint, but, you know, put a little patch on the thing that can read a fingertip. Because I agree with Facebook's observation from their press conference yesterday that crazy logins, or just the fact that everything requires a login, and beefed up security, good passwords require special characters that are hard to type on a mobile device. You have to, you know, change the keyboard from standard letters to you have to click over to get the special characters, and it's very tough, and it's not muscle memory. As Zuckerberg said yesterday, passwords aren't remembering a string, it's muscle memory. And that just has become so difficult on mobile. Maybe that's the ideal place to implement some kind of, thumbprint scanning or something.
I think the answer to that, honestly, is going to sound kind of funny, but it's actually the front-facing camera is the answer there with biometrics. So basically, it takes a picture of you.
Just scan your face.
You know, it basically sees who you are, you know. And, unfortunately, Apple didn't do that with the iPad 1. I, you know, crossed my fingers with the iPad 2. If we actually had that being, you know, things that are across all our devices we have. I mean, I got a MacBook here. If you've got Mac, you know, desktop computers, and a lot of computers have got these webcams. There's no reason why we couldn't use that as sort of a universal logon, at least, you know, for the sites that we want to let that be used as a logon. I mean, we need to have control to whether or not we want to have a backup ability for devices that don't have that, like the iPad. We have to log in with the password anyways, but at least have it be something we could say, hey, you know, or maybe it sends you a PIN code to your phone or something like that while you're walking with your iPad, and it's like, okay, you can basically match the two up. I mean, there's many ways of doing security correct online. And just like you say, you're exactly correct. You need to basically think creatively about it so that it's beyond just a simple, you know, username, password stuff, and including things like the CAPTCHAs and whatnot, you know, that people try to go with for keeping people from generating accounts automatically through a script and whatnot, you know, so.
Yeah, and I love your idea of using the front-facing camera. Because they already, you know, Apple at least already has the scanning your face, right? And identifies the person in iPhoto and in Aperture by the face. So just fill that into the phone and say, oh, that's Eric. Log him into the phone, right?
Right.
Hold it up.
Exactly. And that's kind of where I guess where I'm coming with this is that if we get better security in that area, it'll help definitely push along people's trust in exactly the cloud, because the idea is saying that once I'm walking around with a device, oh yeah, let's, you know, give 2 seconds, look, okay, to your phone, okay, that's who I am. And even, I guess your phone could even tie to your iPad if you want to, basically. You could say, like, and, you know, there could be ways you could talk over Bluetooth or my, you know, the way they're talking about peer-to-peer ad hoc Wi-Fi stuff they were talking about the other day. You know, again, there's lots of ways of making that work, so you can actually have it be, you know, work around some limitations of the hardware that you currently doesn't have cameras, let's just say. But anyways, I digress. I thought it was cute, a comedy basically about the iPod not being mobile, that Zuckerberg said that, because I kind of understand where he's coming from, but it's like, because it doesn't do the same exact thing to the iPhone does, and it, you know, and some of them don't have GPS on them and whatnot. And from their standpoint, that maybe the iPad isn't, you know, similar kind of class of device like the mobile phones and everything. But honestly, with all the tablets coming on board now, they're going to have to look at solutions that will work not just for the iPad, but for the Samsung and all the other tablet devices, the Playbook, these devices that are coming on board that need to be able to check into their services and whatnot. So
I agree. Yeah, maybe they're just sitting back and seeing where tablets are go, where this first generation of them goes, and what form factor and size becomes the most popular. Well, thanks, Brian. Thanks for the call. I'm going to let you get going because I see we've got some other calls going.
Awesome.
Thanks for the call. Some good stuff to get started with.
Yes. Okay, you have a good day.
All right, you too. Thanks for the call.
Bye.
Okay, next call is from Northeast and Central, .. Where is it? It'll tell me if I mouse over it, or maybe it won't. Well, it's Northeast and Central somewhere. Hi, who's this?
Hello?
Pennsylvania. Yes, hi.
Hi,
what's your name?
Caleb.
Say that again?
Caleb.
Caleb, hey, how are you? What's your comment?
I'm fine, how are you?
I'm great.
I was just wondering about the new Windows phone. What exactly is your opinion on that one? Because I've seen a few companies start bashing that before it even came out, and I was contemplating getting one.
I think the Windows Phone 7 platform is exciting for a number of reasons. I think in for what you get pre-installed on the phone, for what Microsoft software has already provided you with, like the integration of Facebook and the various features of the camera and the calendar and all those things, it's pretty good. It's almost like a very good feature phone. But if you're a heavy user of applications, and you want to be able to download lots of games and lots of apps right away, it's not ready for that yet. It doesn't have multitasking, doesn't have copy and paste. So I can't recommend rushing out to get this right away unless you're an experimenter and just like to see the latest, newest thing. At this point in time, it's still Android and iOS have it totally beaten in terms of number of apps and things you can do with the phone itself. However, if what you want is if you are a brand new user of smartphones, you've never used a smartphone before, and you want to get into it without having to navigate through endless screens of applications and have to customize the whole thing yourself, then it might be compelling. But for right now, same price as those other devices, and you just don't get as much.
Right. Yeah. I guess the iPhone and the Android are top tier right now. So I guess that would. I don't know. I guess I'll wait to see what Microsoft will do with what they have.
Wait and see what third-party developers come up with, and see how many actually go to the platform, because that'll be important too. If it turns out that no one goes there and the platform fails, then you don't want to be stuck on a phone and having invested in some apps for a platform that is no longer. But I think fans of competition, for once, might actually be rooting for Microsoft. It's good to see someone trying something new.
I'm sorry, I misunderstood what you said, but I got it now.
Oh, okay. Did you have anything else you wanted to comment on?
No, not really. I just wanted to get someone else's opinion about the Microsoft phone.
Sure, great. Thanks for the call. And yeah, if you look at, I know Engadget, a lot of these places, blogs have done a lot of reviews of these phones. The individual phones themselves often have analogous models that is almost or exactly the same hardware running Android on other carriers, or even in the same carrier, I guess, if you're talking AT&T. So if you're looking for the phone hardware features themselves, you can often get them running Android with obviously a larger ecosystem of apps. Other than that, if you're just interested in the platform, I would say, wait a bit, see how the development goes and see what they come up with.
Right. Okay.
All right, thanks for the call.
All right. Cool. Okay, thanks.
All right.
Nice talking to you.
All right. Thank you for the call. And we need more callers. Man, I know it's a slow news week. I know it's early morning for some, or at work or at school for others. What do you think about this time of day? Give me a tweet at Erik Lanigan, E-R-I-K-L-A-N-I-G-A-N. Does this Are you sitting at somewhere at work or at school listening right now and just can't call because because you just can't call? I'm curious. Or is it because it's earlier than the normal Twitch shows start at 11 a.m. and this is earlier? I don't know, but I used to get a ton of calls at 7 p.m. So it's might have to switch back to that. I thought we'd possibly get more in the morning, but I don't know anymore. So please call in 724-444-7444. Call ID 83337. What else have we got to talk about? MacBook Air. Let's see what I say about that. 7-hour battery, scales very well. Surprisingly fast to charge. You can use the thing for an entire day, and it's fully charged within about an hour and 15 minutes, which is amazing. I think even my old the battery on my old MacBook Pro that used to only last like 2.5 hours at the most would take like 2.5 hours to charge. So 7-hour use to 1-hour charge is pretty extraordinary, if you ask me. It's extremely light. I love being able to walk around with it and not worry about bumping the hard drive and screwing up the drive. No more beach balling and listening to the hard drive just crunch and crunch away while it does who knows what, writes to the swap file or the page file or something. My one complaint about it is the LCD screen, which looks great, and it's got a very it actually it does a better job at reducing reflections. I held it up next to my old glass MacBook Pro towards a light source, and you can clearly see that the MacBook Pro is more like just a glass mirror that reflects everything at full intensity. And the new Airs, if some reviewers have pointed out, seem to have some kind of anti-glare coating, even though it's still considered a glossy screen. You get a little bit contrast reduction, but I think it hits a sweet spot. It's a good trade-off. However, this is the first LCD I've seen on a laptop in a while where the viewing angle is just never quite in the right place. No matter how far away I'm looking at it, it seems I can never get it where if you've got like a single, like you just got a page that has like all black behind it or a gradient or something, or it's all one color, you can see a gradient of contrast changing. You can see the color tone changing. So I find myself, I'm always like tilting it to find what seems like a angle that's constantly changing. And I don't recall doing that on my old 15-inch MacBook Pro. It's a great screen otherwise. I love that it's higher pixel density. That's great. I love the Retina display on the iPhone. I'm a huge fan of pixel density, smoother fonts, not seeing the jagged edges and things. And for that, it's great. It's the same resolution as my 15-inch, which is one of the reasons I went with 13 instead of 11 inches, is because I thought, well, if I ever want to run Final Cut or something on it, I could at least do that and know that I could do some kind of editing, even if it's as slow as an older computer. At least I have a pretty decent size screen real estate on the 13-inch Air. But I have not gone to the cloud storage for everything. I got the larger SSD, and for that I'm using it sort of like an older computer. Matt Brilli in the chat room is asking, would it run Final Cut on that processor? It absolutely would. The computer for me that this is replacing is actually a 2-year-old Core 2 Duo MacBook Pro that has almost the same CPU, and it runs on that just fine. Remember that the current version of Final Cut is actually built for OS 9. So it runs pretty well on anything. Now, if you get into the heavier codecs, you get into problems. But if you're editing DV or HDV, it'll run that just fine. It's when you go to raw compressing, like using compressor or handbrake or something, that you discover that it's not as fast. But for other computing needs, like browsing websites load like that because there's no searching the hard drive to find the cache. There's none of that seek time. It just immediately finds it, which is great. So you've got some more calls right here. Central North Carolina. Hi, who's this?
Hey, this is Kyle.
Hi, Kyle. How are you? What's your comment?
I actually just tuned in, so I just heard you talking about the MacBook Air.
Sure.
And I guess you're having a hard time getting people to call in, so I figured
yes.
I'd give it a shot. I'm
Much
a web developer.
Okay.
And I was thinking, I don't have a laptop at the moment. I have just a main desktop. I was thinking I wanted to get the 11-inch MacBook Air as a main laptop just for a little Dreamweaver, some Photoshop. And I was curious what you thought as far as the processing speed, how that would work out.
What computer is it replacing?
Well, it's not replacing one. I have a pretty beast desktop computer, but I'm on
okay.
the road sometimes. So I just need... I like the portability of the Air. So
oh, okay.
I was just curious. It's I wasn't taking a whole lot of look at the specs. Is it a Core 2 Duo? Is that right?
Yes, it's a Core 2 Duo. It is it's a model that is I've read is up to 3 years old. It's like a
oh, wow.
what is it 1.4? Let me look that up. I think I think the base model
1.4 or 1.6.
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
Yeah, Core 2 Duo. So
there's
it's,
no i3 or i5 in that thing.
No. There is not. So it's in a lot of what you know. When you remember with these Airs, when you look at the price tag, it's easy to look at the price tag and equate that with a level of performance. But what you have to do is remind yourself, well, this is Apple, and you get the great design, and you get that it's this that it's microns thin, and so you know it's really just a super super expensive netbook.
Yeah, I had a MacBook Pro. I got it for a ridiculously subsidized price. A company I was working for gave it to me for $300, and my friend offered me $1,300 for it. So I was like, I need the money, so I took it. And the month I had it, it's just a super sexy piece of hardware, and I kind of want one back. But I don't know if I'm willing to sacrifice the hardware performance for it.
So your question to get back to it was. How about a...
Just Dreamweaver, really. I'll be using Dreamweaver in Photoshop.
For very light duty?
Yeah, when I'm on the road, it's not going to be hardcore stuff, so it would be literally editing a button or something like that, so it's not like multiple layers and stuff like that.
Sure. Well, if that's all you're going to do, if it's very light duty, then I would say yes. I mean, people say Photoshop... people who've reviewed the Air and have tried Photoshop with it have said that while Photoshop is a memory hog, the SSD is so fast that it can write to the page file very quickly to the virtual memory and it does not feel extra slow at all. So as a satellite computer to complement a desktop, I'd say it's pretty good. It's pretty good. If you were using it for, you know, anything higher than the lightest of photo retouching, I would say don't expect to run Photoshop on it. I would also caution you that for programs like that, professional apps that benefit and require a lot of screen real estate, that maybe the 11-inch might be too small. Remember that a lot of those tool palettes are use these little bitmap pixels that are so small that you might not be able to read the screen from a comfortable distance. Remember, it's a 16 by 9 aspect ratio, so it's shorter than most. There's 16 by 10, or like the 13 inches, 16 by 10. And of course, the base model has very little storage. I could never have gone with 64 gigabytes of RAM because when I looked at it, my email alone... The email that I cache over my various IMAP accounts amounts to 15 gigabytes. Now, actually, I may as well give a little tip to everyone. What I did was, when I looked at that and it was loading it up on my new Air, I thought, well, what I'll try, I'll tell it on all my IMAP accounts, I say, do not cache attachments, cache only the messages, and that got it down from 14 point something gigabytes of a cache down to only about 800 megabytes. So that's a very good tip for Air users out there. Don't sync those attachments. Otherwise, you can be using up that SSD in a heartbeat.
Yeah, I've switched all my email accounts over to IMAP. It's a godsend.
Yeah.
But, I think I'm kind of going towards getting a regular MacBook Pro at this point after hearing your comments on the screen size and the little lack of performance.
Yeah, see, that's the thing. If you had said, you know, I want to use it for just basic web browsing and for checking email, RSS feeds, reading, in that case, it's a fantastic machine if you just need a keyboard. You know, think of the 11-inch Air as being for a person who might be fine with an iPad, just someone who needs something, an ultra-portable device that they can use to check their email and get online, but who needs a keyboard, who needs to be able to type quickly and use a keyboard, or use certain Mac applications that may be lightweight but require a Mac that have no iOS equivalent. So for that, the keyboard's great. I mean, that's me. That describes me. I need to be able to write easily. I'll tell you, one of the reasons I went with the Air is that for the longest time, a MacBook Pro has been my main machine, which is also sort of my desktop machine. And what I found was, even though I've used that laptop as my main machine for a few years, it felt like I didn't have a laptop because I couldn't just unplug it and leave the house or unplug it and carry it around or sit comfortably with it in a chair or something, because it was always connected to all these external hard drives. It was always chugging away on rendering a video or downloading some file or even just playing back a downloaded video or something, all off of these external devices, and I just couldn't unplug it. It was always rooted to my desk. So for that, it's great to have this little satellite machine. Well, I went a different route. I got a machine that is, I got the highest end one, which is to replace my main machine. But it's great if you're a user that has a high powered desktop machine, which it sounds like you do, it's great then to have a little satellite machine you can carry around your house and just, you know, close it up, go down to a coffee shop or whatever and just start, you know, whip it out and just start computing.
Yeah, I've gone through so many laptops for years, and the month I had the little MacBook Pro is my favorite one. I'm kind of a little disappointed in myself in selling it, so I think I'm gonna.
Well, I'll tell you,
have to go get another.
I'll tell you, the biggest, I would recommend this for you, and I'd recommend this to everyone. The biggest upgrade that you can make, as I'm seeing now, to a MacBook Pro is an SSD. And if you're in the market for a MacBook Pro, something that is, you don't mind it being heavier or larger, the speed is what matters, I would definitely say, first of all, wait to see what Apple announces, because I think that they're going to announce some hardware updates to the pros before the holiday buying season. So I would definitely wait to see what they announce, because I think the current models were not updated since early this year, and they always have some update for by October or so. They're running late. I think last year was October. It might be around November this year. I think there will be some update to the pros. But then when they do that, I would certainly look at how much you could afford to get an SSD put in there. Because once you have the freedom of not having to worry about rattling a hard drive that could break, and you have the speed of an SSD, or you can get one of those mods where you put in an SSD in place of the optical drive, I've just found that life with an SSD is just made a huge difference.
Yeah, I mean, a few years ago it was just absolutely ridiculous, but I've been looking around and it's getting close to the price to performance ratio. It's getting pretty close to being really worth it for almost everyone to have one.
Mm-hmm.
But I actually got to get back to work. I appreciate you taking my call.
Sure, I appreciate you calling.
And have a good one. Talk to you guys later.
You too. Thanks for the call.
All right. Bye.
Bye-bye. And we need more calls. We need calls, darn it. You know, when there's a big news story, like when Steve Jobs did his thing 2 weeks ago, man, we had a call queue that just would not stop. There were people calling in. I couldn't take all the calls. That's also how it was at the later time slot. So, prove me wrong, please. Let's see if we can make this time slot work and if this show can even run when there's no particular news going. You can call in and talk about anything that you'd like to in the world of tech. And I will take that call and I will talk with you about it or be a good listener or whatever you'd like to come out of it. Let's see. There's got to be something to talk about. Smartphone. Well, I see a call came in, so I'm going to go to that. here's something to think about. Fortune magazine had an article recently about smartphone addiction. Smartphones are a new drug of choice, saying that people are addicted to smartphones, that it's this whole thing about like you get this release of, what is it, endorphins or something when you see a new tweet or a new email message come in and then you read it. But my take on this, I'd love to hear your take, is whether you think that is actually some addiction to the device itself, or what I suspect is it's just the same addiction that we all have, human beings, for our entire existence, which is we are addicted to social connections and talking to people. And if your friends are on your phone, if that's where you've got people coming in, you've got your friends saying stuff to you on the phone, you'll be looking at your phone, just like you will be talking to them in person. That's like saying, oh, you're addicted to your best friend who's in the room with you because you're talking to that person. No, that's ridiculous. If you've got people communicating with you over the phone, it's going to look like you're addicted to the phone. But what you're addicted to are the same human connections you would get in any other context. That's my take on that. What's your take on that? 724-444-7444, call ID 83337. Whoa, seven calls just came right in. I hope that, I certainly hope that TalkShoe is not delaying or something that is causing me not to see calls that are in there, because that would not be a good thing, would it? 724-444-7444, call ID 83337. This is Tech TalkBack. I'm Erik Lanigan. Let's take this next call from a caller in California. Hi, who's this?
Hey, Erik, it's Jeff in San Francisco.
Hello, Jeff. What is your comments?
Well, first of all, I think we're definitely addicted to the human contact.
Absolutely.
I use the iPhone 4 and before that the iPhone 3 and the iPhone 1 and so on and so forth. But for me, it's definitely about the human contact and staying in touch with my peers and with my coworkers. So that's what it is for me. I wanted to sort of just follow up on your thread about the about SSD and storage in the Air and MacBook Pros and whatnot, and kind of tell you what I'm doing with my MacBook Pro i7 15-inch, because I actually just kind of fired on this last night. Of course I'm in love with the new Airs. I had the original Air, the first one, and I gifted it to my brother. And that thing was such a dog, such a complete dog, that it's kind of really soured my taste on the Air name.
Was that the older SSD, or did you have that really slow hard drive that everyone complained about?
I had that really slow, the iPod hard drive.
Yeah, 4,800 RPM.
Yes.
4,200.
And the thing was, believe me, Erik, it was such a dog. That, you know, it's kind of soured me, and of course I've heard Leo and his guests, you know, just praising the new Air, but, you know, I sort of feel like, you know, once bitten, twice shy.
So are you saying that you are interested in, you're looking at the Air, but you think that it just might not
well,
be?
I'd love to have one, but, you know, I do have an iPad, and I don't know how I could justify it. I'm a graphic and web designer, just like the previous caller, and the thing I really need is storage. So what I did last night, I'm getting my feet wet with Motion and with Final Cut, as well as spending a lot of time in Photoshop and so on and so forth. So when I bought my custom build to order i7, I, of course, got the 500 gig 7200 RPM spindle speed drive. And I'm moving down from a tower with 4 terabyte drives. You know, kind of that's a big backward step.
Sure.
But I just noticed last night I got an email from one of the big Mac mail order companies that they're selling. They've just released the Seagate 750 gigabyte laptop 7200 spindle speed drive. So I ordered one of those last night. So I'm going to swap it out because I'm constantly bumping my head on that 500 gig storage limit.
Yeah.
So I'm going to do that over the holiday season is clone the drive, the 500, and they do ship you an external case with the new drive. So I'm going to put the old 500 in that and mount this new 9.5-millimeter Seagate drive in the i7 MacBook Pro and hopefully move up to 750 gigs of good storage, and hopefully that should alleviate some of my storage woes.
And that should
be the SSD.
Oh, and no. Go ahead.
Oh, go ahead.
Oh, I was going to point out that when you get a hard drive that is that speed and that capacity, when you get up to like 750 gigs or a terabyte in a laptop hard drive, the aerial density on that hard drive becomes so dense that it actually becomes a lot faster than an older hard drive where the bits are more spread out. So you'll get a good speed increase, but certainly nothing compared to an SSD.
That That's interesting, since this this i7 is only about 10 months old.
I'm sorry, I didn't understand the last thing you said.
Oh, I said that's interesting, because especially considering that this i7 MacBook Pro is really only about 10 months old.
Oh, you're referring to the hard drive that it's going to replace?
Yes.
Oh, maybe I missed that. What is the characteristics of that hard drive?
It's also a Seagate, 7200 spindle speed, 9.5 millimeter height, but it's only 500 gigs.
Okay, so
it's also part of the Omentis line.
Yeah, 500 and 750. It's not okay. So that's not really going to be that big of an increase. But you know where you would see a huge increase, and there's a mod out there, and I know Leo did this like a year ago on a MacBook Pro. There's a company that will give you a kit that will help you. I'm sure it voids your warranty, but you can remove your optical drive and then in its place install an SSD.
Yes, so, I've seen that mod.
Yeah, so what?
I've heard of that mod, and that's something that's been very interesting to me. But you know, I worry about losing that optical drive. You know, sort of hanging out with Final Cut and Motion and the Adobe Studio and stuff. I feed those little silver discs in probably more than most casual users.
Oh yeah. Well, remember, you can, if you're on a desktop machine, if you have a USB optical drive lying around, like I have a DVD burner always on USB handy. You can get for $80. You can get the little slim portable one from Apple. Although I don't know if those work on the regular MacBook Pros.
They don't.
Hmm.
I'd be interested in hearing a thread about the new Air opticals in terms of, you know, when the original Air optical shipped. I think it was Tuow figured out that it would only work with the Air.
Hmm. Well, I know that you can get other slim drives from other manufacturers for those instances that... and remember, I mean, the Air is very good about, even if you're on a Windows machine, first of all, if you're on any local network that has a Leopard or higher Mac on it, you can put a disk, a CD or DVD into that drive, and as long as it has disk sharing, CD/DVD sharing turned on in its system preference, it will show up on the Air, and the Air can use it as a disk. Now, for me, I said that's fine, because at the rare amounts of time that I am on the go and need to use an optical disk and can't load it in ahead of time, like if it's a movie or something, that will suit me just fine, because that almost never happens. But if that's an issue for you, I would either consider that, or I would look at third-party non-Apple portable drives, because you can get some very slim ones that are highly portable, some of which don't require a power source. But to answer your question about the SSD speeds, I think it's a difficult choice that you have to make right now, because the number of combinations of hardware, the permutations that you can make between performance and portability trade-offs, and they blur together, don't they? Because here the MacBook Air has people spending in some cases less, or you could argue more, for something that is slower, but in some ways faster, right? Because it's SSD. But then if you were to add an SSD drive to a larger machine, whether it's a desktop machine or a laptop, those, a high performance SSD can cost you hundreds of dollars for just a couple of gigabytes, like 256 gigabytes or something ridiculously small. But I think right now the sweet spot for that kind of performance is to buy an SSD that you load your operating system onto, and you set up your page file, your swap file to be on there, but then you store all your user data on a regular high-capacity hard drive. If I were, and this was the decision that I went through when it came time I needed a new laptop in the last couple of weeks or months, I was waiting to see what Apple announced. MacBook Pros, they haven't announced those yet, but they had the Airs. And I was thinking, well, my computing is really divided into very high-performance needs like video editing and compressing and rendering and things, and very light performance, like reading and email and just basic web browsing and ultra-portable style things. And for that purpose, it made more sense to me to have something that was very portable and light that I could carry everywhere with me, and that could talk back over, I'm going to try getting back to my Mac setup. I've already got, you know, screen sharing, VNC setup, and control the home machine that is sitting there, that's my file server, that's got my terabytes of data connected to it, that I can call up at any time in those rare cases where I'm out and I just suddenly need something. I can just dial in and get it, basically.
Yeah. Like to leave you on a question for our show and for the other callers, which is, like to get your opinion and any other callers who call in after about the best way to learn Final Cut Studio.
Best way to learn Final Cut Studio. It depends on what kind of a learner you are. If you're someone who likes to be in a classroom, likes to hear people talking, likes to ask a lot of questions, then a classroom is best. If you're a person who learns better through reading, then reading is best. But what my personal experience is that classes move too slowly and don't cover enough. And books, when you're reading a book about how to control a user interface, there is too much of a gap between the way the information is communicated in print, describing things on a screen, then your brain has to translate that into images and actions and concepts that then you have to go to a screen and figure out. And I think in that process, it becomes not just hard to understand, but hard to remember. And I found that I didn't remember or retain the information I learned as much from those books, and it took me a lot longer. So what I found is the best way to learn applications of any kind, especially Final Cut Studio, are video tutorials. Now, the ones I like, well, the only ones I've tried, and know they've got other good ones like Ripple Training and the others too, a lot have good samples. The Ripple Training guys are the ones who are always on MacBreak HD. Alex Lindsay does at the Pixel Core. But lynda.com has great tutorials on all these things, and what they let you do is play the files at double the speed. And that's what I do, because I find that when it's at double the speed, I can take it in a lot better, and I remember it a lot better, and by seeing the cursor and seeing the windows going and stuff like that, and actually seeing on screen what the person is doing, I find that, and it seems logical to me that that would be an easier way to learn, because it's almost like you're watching yourself do it, right?
Right, and especially with learning. It would be different if one was learning like Illustrator or Photoshop, which is a still-based program. But with a motion-based program, it's a completely different deal.
I don't think so, actually. I guess what I'm referring to is watching places on the screen. Like when they say, click the such-and-such menu in the such-and-such area, you know, they have to go through all these words on a page just to describe, you know, a picture's worth 1,000 words, right? You have to go through all these words to describe what in the heck they're talking about, where this bizarre non-standard icon is living, somewhere on this densely populated screen full of toolbars and menus and functions, instead of just seeing the cursor go, boop, just click,
yeah,
and then you know
Final Cut interface is daunting.
It is. It is. It's a very high barrier to entry. But once you're there, you can do some pretty powerful stuff. So that's my answer for you for that. High-speed video tutorials.
And you mentioned also, too, Ripple.com. What are they about?
Ripple Training. They do very similar to what Lynda does. They just do various training courses, DVDs, and web videos for Final Cut Studio. And other companies do this, too. If you Google, you can find some, and they almost all have some demo files you can watch online and see which you like or which is the best, a good pace or a good narrator or a good range of topics, advanced or beginner, or you know, anything like that you'd like.
Well, thank you for the show, Eric.
Oh, thank you. Thanks for the call.
Bye.
All right, take care. Okay, let's go to the next call, which is in West Northeast Illinois, Chicago suburbs. Hi, who's this?
Hey, Eric, it's Dan Lueders.
Hi, Dan.
How are you?
I'm great. How are you?
Good.
You've made quite an excellent theme song for me.
Oh, fantastic. Have you been using it?
Not yet. I've got to get it loaded up here. I want to start using it.
Great.
I've got Dan Lueders has made just the best theme song I've ever heard. And I'm going to use it for Tech TalkBack and also for some other things I'm working on. But it is so cool. And he is the master of theme songs. So, hey, how are you? What did you like to call in and comment on?
Well, I was just listening to the last guy, and I too recommend lynda.com for the tutorials. I took the essential trainings on Final Cut and also WordPress, and you know they're basic. They're great for just getting started, and then you know it's like with any of these programs. Once you understand one basic function, you can expand, and everything else works kind of the same way. You know what I mean?
Whoa, I just got a bizarre interference on my headphone. I just heard someone else. But yes, no, I totally agree.
Yeah. Oh. And just getting back to the previous conversation about the MacBook Air is I'm doing what you're looking at doing. I've got I use a MacBook Pro 13-inch, and I use back to my Mac for my Mac Pro in my studio. And, you know, sometimes we're just waiting for things to render and get done, and I can just do little controls. I can work on email and all the light duty stuff.
Exactly.
In the comfort of my lazy chair.
Exactly,
know?
for when the big machine is tied up.
Right, exactly. But I can still monitor it, and, you know, I can do that from Starbucks. I can do that from here. I'm not tied down, so, you know, I'm a big guy for, you know, use the proper tool for the job, you know. Not very handy around the house, but mostly because I don't have the right tools.
That's great. I'm trying to pull up something that you'll see is relevant in a minute. But so, Dan, I've never gotten to talk to you, and I'm sure others are very interested too, because you make all the theme songs, just amazing, awesome theme songs that sound, you know, like they just came off the radio or off of a professional album. Why don't you tell the folks a little bit about your setup? What do you do? What is your day job? What is the setup like in your? Is it a home studio or how do you have that going? And what software and tools do you use?
Oh yeah, sure. Well, I live out in Streamwood, Illinois, which is about about 45 minutes west of downtown Chicago, and I work in children's ministry at mega church out here called Willow Creek Community Church. And we have like 18,000 people coming through each weekend, you know, so we have a huge children's ministry, and I'm the music director, and I create music for kids all the way from 2-year-olds to, you know, 12-year-olds, just songs to help them, you know the Bible better and to, you know, just ways for them to learn about God and about how to worship and all that stuff. And so
you're making a lot of music.
I'm making a ton of music. And there's a team of people here too, that I have other writers that help, with lyrics and stuff like that. I'm mostly a songwriter and a producer. And I record all the instruments, and I'll bring vocalists in sometimes and to do parts, but built a studio downstairs in my basement, and I'm running a Mac Pro quad, like 6 gigabytes of RAM. I have a live room, which is just, you know, like the size of a typical living room, where I can put vocalists or guitarists or drums or whatever, and then I have a little control room that I'm in, and basically, I'm using Digital Performer by Mark of the Unicorn is the rig I, you know, cut my teeth on and still using that. And, you know, it's always a learning thing. And, you know, the whole podcast world has been a tremendous, has really, really helped us. Great audio podcasts out there that kind of, you know, guys like me, you know, just kind of trading their secrets about how, oh, that's how you do that. Oh, that's how you do that. Okay. You know, and how you can do things, you know, on a shoestring budget, you know.
Yeah. Podcasting has ignited this whole, a whole new hobbyist territory in audio and video production.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So I developed a little studio called Why Me Studios. And, you know, so I do, that's where, how we met. I do a little work on the side with Leo, and I've done some stuff with CNET, and I actually did a theme song for a coffee shop in Bangkok, of all things.
A theme song for a coffee shop? How does that work? Is it a show they're doing?
No, it's just an MP3 that they loop throughout the coffee shop. You know, every, you know, half hour the theme song comes on.
Fascinating.
Go to danlueders.com, that's danlueders.com, and everything I'm doing is on there. I haven't put yours up there yet. I'm waiting for you to go official with it, and then I'll throw it up there. Shall we call it the Erik Lanigan thing? We haven't named it yet.
Well, I think
I'll leave that to you. You can name it right now. It's the right now theme.
Intake is probably the theme, and if you're curious what that means, it's something that I'm working on. If you go to my website, you'll see sort of a beta of that. But when I do the official launch of that pretty soon, so we'll call that the intake theme. But I'm also going to use it for Tech Talkback. And as soon as this, I'm going to keep you on until this downloads. You send it is taking forever because I want you to be on as I debut the first public playing of your amazing new theme song. But here, so I'm on danlueders.com, and I've got to hear this this coffee shop theme song. You said it's on there?
Yeah, it's go to Why Me. I think click on Why Me, it says,
Why Me Studios, okay.
Yeah, and it should be towards the bottom.
Towards the bottom. What's it called? Oh, iCoffee?
iCoffee, yeah.
Okay, let's hear what this sounds like.
We've got the best coffee, cappuccino, mi amigo, Americano, coco mocha, perfecto espresso, frappe cappuccino, a sandwich today, a fruit smoothie, tasty cookies, or lots and lots and lots of latte.
Man, that's great. How did you? Oh, that muted him as well. Okay, now I should hear you. That's great. How did that happen? How did they contact you? You said that's for a coffee shop in Bangkok. How did they find you? How did that whole thing work? That's funny. I've never heard of a theme song for a any kind of establishment that would just like you said it like plays like on the hour or something in their store.
Yeah, something like that. I haven't. It was about a year ago, and actually came through the Daily Gizwiz. Just
really?
a listener on the Daily Gizwiz,
Wait, hold on. That started too soon, and right now I've got all the audio going through the same computer. Hold on, Dan. We lost your audio. 1 second. Okay, you there?
Yeah, I'm there.
Okay. You were saying?
I would say probably about a year ago, and it was through the Daily Gizwiz. It was one of the listeners of the Daily Gizwiz that... Like said, hey, I like what you're doing. I need a theme. Okay, no problem.
That's
so
funny.
Yeah, a little Beatlesque, a little just fun play on words. You know, just I love doing these kind of things because it doesn't limitate your creative. You know, I love doing the themes. They're short and sweet, and you can kind of just get to the point. And the tricky part is just doing something catchy, something that somebody's going to walk away humming,
Absolutely. I mean, you are the master, in my opinion, of doing catchy theme songs, catchy jingles. And I want to play for folks right now. Hold on. I'm going to have to mute this because it's going to come up and it's going to be blaring. So I'll lose you for 1 second. Hold on.
Okay.
So if you're just tuning in... We're talking with Dan Lueders, who just called in. Dan Lueders makes all the theme songs for the Twit Network, and he has made a theme song for me. We are debuting it now for the very first time, the theme song to Tech Talk Back and also to a show called Intake. And here we go. Let's listen to it.
Hit it, Maestro.
Isn't this great? Best theme song ever. Let's see, where's the bridge in here? I don't know where it is in this cut. Let me fast forward. There we go. I love the bridge. Here it comes. And here's the cut. We'll go to the end. Yeah, there we go. The newest song from Dan Lueders. That's awesome. Dan, how do you make those? Like, I mean, tell us about the equipment you're using, and like, how long did it take you to make that song, for instance?
Well, the particular person who hired me for this was a stickler. I mean, I tell you, he just would not let...
He's such a jerk. I know. It's like, God, change every little thing. Man, who could work with that person?
Actually, how we did this is... you sent me information on, you know, what you wanted the style to be, how, you know, what kind of energy it wanted to have. So basically how I do it, and I think it's similar to how other guys do it, but I started off with drums, the drum beats, and I use a program called Superior Drums, and they to me, to my ears, they just sound so natural.
You on Mac or Windows?
I'm on Mac. A digital performer on Mac, and they come with a lot of MIDI beats. So it's a great, if you just want to throw stuff up and just kind of get things going, you know, get your beats going, and they're all, you know, hyper editable, you know, so you can get it to do exactly what you want. So start there, then add the bass part, and then actually my son played guitar on the bridge part that you really like. That's my oldest boy. He's 22, and he played guitar on that. And you know, and then usually bring in vocals, or you know, and use, you know, heavy compression and limiters and just different kind of filters to get, you know, that saturated you know, tube sound.
And what kind of hardware are you using on this? Is it a Mac Pro? Is it what kind of speed is required for this kind of production?
I use a Mac Pro Quad. It's about a 3-year-old machine, but it's plenty fast. And I've got, like, you know, 6 terabytes of storage. And but I've been using a lot of I don't know what it's called. It's like it's outboard. It's, well, United Audio has the UAD-1 plugins, and Universal Audio is just on the high end of signal processors. But the nice thing, it's a PCIe card that installs right into your computer, so it takes the workload off the CPU, which is fantastic. So I have a couple of pieces of gear like that, like Liquid Mix and the UAD software.
How about speakers? What do you use to? Really, what are your? You probably have some studio monitors. What are your favorites?
Yeah, I'm using KRKs. They're the eight inch KRKs, and they're the ones with the yellow Kevlon. Yeah. So they're pretty indestructible. They sound fantastic. They're a little beefy on the bottom. So in my room, kind of is a little beefy on the bottom. So I usually struggle with the low end stuff, but. If I put it through a couple different machines and check it, it's usually okay.
And so you're doing the whole thing, like the whole mixing and recording, then you're doing through Digital Performer?
Right. Everything's in the box. Everything, I have very little. The only outboard equipment I used on this particular song was the mic preamp, you know, and everything else was done in the computer.
And how about, do you have a, what do you use, what kind of interface do you use? Is it a FireWire interface? Or I didn't quite understand what you're saying about the PCI interface, if that was just a CPU offloading or if that was also the audio capture device. What do you use to bring the audio in?
I use an M Audio Project Mixed. It's a, it's like, kind of like the DigiDesign 003. It's an automated control surface made by M Audio. I think it was made before Advid bought M Audio, but it's the same, almost the same thing as the Digi 03. So it's got automated faders and that kind of stuff, which really streamlines things. You know,
that's great. Yeah, and how do you get such a professional sound? Because all your stuff sounds so well mixed. Are you using some kind of mastering? How are you mastering it? Are you using like multi-band compression or something on the way out?
Really, the trick to it is, and it may sound simple, is just make sure it's good going in. You know what I mean? Just make sure. I never have the attitude, I'll fix it in the mix. You know, I'll fix it later. It's like when I'm committing it to recording, have it be pretty close to the way I want it to sound at the end. Then you don't have to do a whole lot. That means if the bass part I play isn't even or is not in sync or out of time, I don't have to go back and slice it up and fix it.
Oh, sure.
It's like get it right the first time kind of attitude. And at the end, I just use either one of the things that, again, I learned this from a podcast, my friend Alan Wagner at the, he hasn't had a podcast, Project Studio Network podcast. And he swore by, you know, what's happening in the digital world is as everything is from analog has gone digital, that what has been lost is the distortion, that nice harmonic distortion that happens through an analog console. And so the funny thing is I've got plugins now to kind of bring that back, like tape saturation. There's something about when an audio signal hits tape really hard, it starts to break up, but in a real musical way. Mm-hmm. Now there's plugins that do that. So I think that's what your ear is hearing. It's kind of like, it sounds like it's on the radio because it's kind of breaking up a little bit, but it's pleasing to the ear. You know, so I use...
It's a pleasing distortion.
And so it's... I use a program called Color Tone Pro, and it's just a little thing that I put on the master bus, the very last thing. And or I'll use like a Fairchild. I think it's by Waves. It's a Pugh Child. It's a
emulation. I don't know what any of those are.
It adds some grit.
That's great because your theme songs always come out sounding so professional and evenly mixed. How long does it take you to do a typical theme song for Twit? Not including that one, because I was a stickler on a lot of things. But for a basic one, where they just say, you know, think of something, go.
Yeah, four to 8 hours, somewhere in that neighborhood. Depends on the complexity, you know. Like that particular one that we did, there was seven separate guitar parts, a bass part, and then the drums. So it wasn't that complex. It's just that we had a ball tweaking it and just getting it just right, and it was fun actually. Typically, you know, it depends. Like the one I did for my personal favorite is the one I did with Dr. Tiki, her theme show.
I love that one. That was the one actually where I saw and I thought, man, Dan Lueders can write pop songs. I mean, that is like I heard that and it was like something that you would hear on the radio, the Dr. Tiki Science Hour theme.
I would love to hear the vocal version as the outro of that show. That would be because I like the vocal version too. Because I do the.
It
little,
is, isn't it? Did they change it? I always used to play the vocal version out.
Yeah, they use the instrumental, but I did. Kirsten thought that I sampled the science at the end. You know, from Blinding Me with Science.
No, that's you.
That's me. And I think it's hilarious at the end. And I'm like, oh, man, everybody misses that joke. Yeah. Nobody gets that joke, you know. So, I'd love to hear that.
I'm trying to pull it up right now. I guess they changed it. I used to do at least one verse on the outro.
Well, you know, I can get into the intro because the words kind of step over the narrative coming in, the voiceover coming in. So, you might as well not have lyric there.
What is your secret for coming up with such catchy riffs for these theme songs? Or matching particular styles? I'm curious, is there a process that you go through of you try out various melodies? Or, I mean, I'm assuming that most of it is just a gift for coming up with for something that is catchy, but do you have a process that might lead people to do similar things?
Oh, boy, that's a great question. I played in all through my 20s and early 30s. I just played in a ton of bands, you know, and just played night after night, and mostly what we played were, you know, the top 40, the most popular stuff, and this was in the 80s, and I was always a big, you know, Zeppelin fan, big rock and roll fan, love Motown, love the Beatles, You know, so I just surrounded myself with excellence, you know, just surrounded myself with the best players and the best music. And, you know, sometimes after a while, you just kind of instinctively know. I don't know how else to explain it. It just, I guess you just keep trying things until I like it, and I say, well, I would listen to that, you know, or something that. Another thing is, you know, doing children's music is, everything is very repetitive. So one of the things is if it gets stuck in my head, then it's probably a good thing, you know, that if it sticks in my head relatively quickly. And another thing is I just think every part of a song or even a 30-second jingle, every aspect, every second of it should be interesting. There should be something interesting happening, you know, either a hooky line on a guitar or an interesting rhythm or interesting texture in a keyboard or interesting vocal of some kind. And you look at Motown and the Beatles, and that's what they did. Everything they did was interesting like that. I mean, they were the masters of hooks, and so I guess I went to the Beatles school of.
I totally agree with you on that observation with Motown and the Beatles and everything. They all have those little what's the word? I learned it at some point. The where they have especially with the old like 60s R&B stuff, how they had it's just multiple layers of little catchy riffs, or I'm sure you know the word, but it's just these little
ear candy.
Well, yes, but there's some other word too. But yeah, where it was just those little things layered on top that were all just so many little catchy parts on all that.
Yeah. So that's, you know, and I grew to appreciate all that, you know, and you know, after you get to know a part, a song, and then I've led several bands, and I would have to dissect the, you know, the Beatles song or whatever song we were doing, and okay, what's the bass doing? What's the drums doing? What's the guitar doing? You know, and I kind of isolate all that, so I, you know, and learn the song. So after a while, you know, there's only 12 notes, and there's only so many combinations you can do. Chances are, I'm not doing anything particularly original. You know, it's all been done before.
Yeah, that's true with so many, well, any kind of creative thing, especially music. There's someone's always done that riff or right. That beat or something.
Exactly.
Let's see, I'm trying to find for everyone the full lyrical version of the Dr. Kiki Science Hour theme, because it is definitely one of my favorites of the Dan Lueders themes. And
Is it on the Dropio?
It is. I'm searching through my emails from last year. So let's see.
Be able to give you the link.
Instrumental vocal edit. Instrumental vocal edit. Would that be it? Well, we'll give it a try anyway. If it downloads soon. Let's see. It's Dropio. We always use Dropio for this, and now you can't upload anymore.
I know.
Facebook bought them out.
very disappointed in that.
Yeah, you can download your old drops, as they call them, which is what I'm doing right now, but no more new Dropio files can be uploaded for free, at least. So let's see. I think it's going to come up any second. This is the Dr. Kiki Science Hour theme from Dan Lueders. Oh. Shoot, maybe it's not the... Oh, here we go.
Yeah, is it at the end?
Here come the lyrics. Here you go. I'm not sure if everyone have heard the lyrics before, but yeah, that's an awesome song, and it's clearly something that, I mean, you could hear that on the radio, right? That's awesome.
Yeah, thanks. I appreciate that.
Well, thanks so much, Dan, and thanks for staying on and talking. I think some interesting stuff. I've always wanted to find out some of the stuff like that about how you make your songs, how you make the Twit theme songs, and to debut the one you made for me. And I'll play that out. I'll use that to play myself out at the end of this show. tell people, where can they find you? And do you offer, can people hire you to make theme songs like that for things they might be working on themselves?
Absolutely. You just go to danlueders.com. That's danlueders.com.
Yeah, if only there was a way. it might be wise for you to buy up like every possible way to spell your last name, because that is not the easiest to spell. There's a.
Yeah, I think you're right.
Let's see, where is it? Oh, that's not the preview. There you go. It's spelled like Lueders is how I remember it.
Lueders.
Yeah.
Well, you think of Lou like Lou. There it is. Yeah, you got it.
Dan Lueders, maker of the awesome Twit theme songs. Thanks so much.
Actually, I don't have a body, just eyes. I just have eyes. That's all I have.
Well, it works, I guess, because you're making awesome theme songs. All right, thanks so much, Dan.
I'm watching you.
The eyes of Dan Lueders are watching.
All right, man. Have yourself a great day.
All right, you too. Talk to you
soon.
Bye. And thanks for calling in. That was a nice surprise. Dan Lueders, who makes all the Twit theme songs, made one for me, just called in, and I got to ask him about his studio and how he mixes and writes his songs and everything. I think that's pretty cool. We've got maybe 15 minutes left to go here on Tech TalkBack. If you're just tuning in, I'm Erik Lanigan, and talking about anything that you'd like to talk about in tech, and we're not afraid to get sidetracked when something very interesting happens, when someone very interesting calls in. But for now, the number to call to get back to our regularly scheduled theme of just talking about anything that interests you in tech, whether it's a gadget, an app, or a concept, the number to call is 724-444-7444. Call ID 83337. I apologize because right before Dan called, and I wasn't expecting that, but I think we all really enjoyed that. I know I did. I just suddenly had gotten a flood of calls with people talking, I think having comments about the supposed smartphone addiction and whether or not smartphones are themselves actually addictive, or whether people are just addicted to the social connections that the smartphones enable. You know, they say that you've got people out there saying, oh, smartphones are addictive because they have the same kind of pleasure release that like a drug does or something. When people see they've got a new email, so they're constantly checking and they're addicted to seeing for that little rush of pleasure when they see something come in. Well, my take on that is that I think people are not addicted to the devices themselves, or that even the matter of checking, but rather to the people, the communication that those devices enable. I think, you know, as a species, where we are addicted to human connections and friends and family and coworkers and talking with people. And we even need to know what people are talking and saying to us and about us and what's going on with them. Even at times being, wanting to spy on people with things like Foursquare and the places. Hey, where's that guy right now? Right. So, what do you think about that? Are we merely addicted to human connections, or is it something indicative of the devices themselves? 724-444-7444. Use the call ID 83337. Tech Talk Back. Taking your calls. Let's take this call from TakeLT2 is the username. What's your first name and where are you calling from?
Take it two.
Take it two.
Paul, I'm in Chicago. And I'm also in the chat room, and I'm always just take it to, but it's Paul. And Erik, what a great little conversation you had with Dan there. That was
Wasn't
fantastic.
That great?
He's a hard call to follow, too, you know, try and keep things interesting. And, you know, I think as far as the addiction part goes, I think, you know, there's always, we always need contact. You know, so any type of, I think that's going to be sort of built in. But I think what the smart devices do is like what you were talking about with the tutorials. What's a good way to learn the tutorials, and you have, you know, sort of this immediate interaction with a faster tutorials. you know, I think what the smart devices do is give you that sort of quick interaction for tools that help keep that contact that we need and use on a daily basis. It's a tool for that, you know, and I think I think the base addiction is the contact that we need in life. You know, and that's just a human condition issue that's never going to go away. And hopefully these tools, become less cumbersome, like you were saying, you know, about the interface of the application being, you know, a tough thing to learn, that these tools just become smarter and you know, generationally speaking, you know, they start progressing along Moore's Law, you know, so that they become more and more intuitive. I suppose, you know, outside of that comment, the thing that prompted me to call was, you know, you were talking about the laptops, and, you know, you have, you know, this laptop as a desktop replacement.
Mm-hmm.
And all these things are now hooked up to it, and you can't take it anywhere anymore. You know, and it's kind of, you know, we wanted less stuff on our desktop, and now, you know, or, you know, a smaller device on our desktop, and we get that, and we start adding this other stuff that we want, too. You know, and the thing that you know, my wife just bought, you know, one of the netbooks. It was inexpensive. It was on sale, like $200, and she bought a netbook. And, you know, I was looking at, the upgrades for, you know, like a smart solid-state drive and the like. And the thing that bugs me about the laptops or the netbooks or the portable devices is there, you know, like a netbook or a tablet, it's considered a desktop. So, like, if you do have, you know, your storage of your, you know, media stuff on, you know, a home server or whatever else, you know, to list a netbook or a laptop like an iPod, like you would an iPod, you know, and be able to carry it around portable, you know, you don't want, you know, those files generally living on your, you know, netbook or your portable device. You know, but none of the software takes that into consideration. They all treat it as though it's a desktop, and that's my. I'm in front of desktops all the time, so I don't really I don't really think about portable devices, or I don't even have a cell phone. So you know, I mean, carrying a smart device would be great if I had a need for it, but I don't really have a need for it because I'm always kind of in one place.
And you're right. I mean, you make the point that you know, these devices going to the greater and greater prevalence of these devices like iPads and netbooks and MacBook Airs that have very small local storage highlights the fact that we really want everything to be in the cloud. We want things accessible from multiple devices, whether it's a phone or any of these portable products, as well as our desktop machine or even our television set, whatever's connected to it, and in those terms,
right, and to recognize the difference.
The difference of what?
And to recognize the difference of what location we're using it in. You know, so if you unplug the network cable, then you know they're smart enough at this point where the wireless card comes on, and reconnects wirelessly. You know, or then if you plug in the HDMI cable to your TV, you know, it recognizes, oh, now I'm connected to a TV, and it brings up, you know, another type of, you know, connection possibility. Having those things be thought about in use cases, you know, as the generations of software. I think the software, you know, is just dramatically so much better in the past 5 years. You know, and it really has been coming along. I just, you know, sometimes I think, you know, people look at it, you know, as only how they're using it, rather than, you know, I downloaded Steam to the netbook for my wife because she plays games. I don't play games. She plays games. And you know, I mean, some of the games, you know, they come on there and, you know, they're not designed for the netbook CPU, and so they just won't play. And it's like the folks at Steam don't say, oh, this one won't run, you know, so why bother downloading it?
You know what I haven't tried yet is OnLive with the MacBook Air and see how that runs. Maybe that's the future of gaming. Don't even worry about putting, you know, these power hungry, don't even worry about the performance and the price ratio for what you can get in an ultra portable. Think about the actual heat and CPU requirements and GPU requirements that you know, real gaming takes, and maybe something like OnLive becomes the future of gaming. Talk about cloud gaming. There you go.
Yeah.
Let's see. Well, Paul, we've got some more calls to go, and I've only got about less than 10 minutes left, I'm going to say thanks for the call.
Sure. One thing for maybe later callers is the RIAA suit that happened news-wise this past week, and the judgment against the individual is certainly a current news topic. So
the one
I'll leave that for you guys.
Sure. You're referring to the one from this morning?
Yeah. Basically, you know, and I was only just reading it while I was on hold, and I'm not really up to speed on it, but the judge said, you know, to bring the damages in line with actual damages. So,
oh, well.
You know, the excessive damages, you know, they're looking at that against the way the law was written as being excessive and unconstitutional. And I think that was a past decision. I don't really think that was this morning, though.
Right. That was certainly a past decision. Actually, this morning, it turned out to be far worse for this person. This is the woman who is, I think this was her fourth or fifth, with the RIAA for being sued for sharing files on LimeWire. And she was originally, one of the trials came out that she was, that she owed like $1.5 million total to the RIAA for sharing like 20 songs. And then a judge said, that's totally unreasonable. Let's knock it down to something like instead of being like $25,000 per infringing song, bump it down to like $2,000. But then, with the backing of the EFF, they pursued it further. They appealed that. And just this morning, it came out that a new ruling with a jury and everything was reached with that. And unfortunately, the new jury and the new judge said back to $1.5 million. And according to one of the articles I read, the judge who had called that ridiculously unfair, he called it monstrous before, that judge was in the room, and he just walked out shaking his head when he heard the verdict, is what one of the sources was reporting. The lawyers, who I think might just be the EFF lawyers, I'm not sure at this point, but certainly the folks representing this woman say that they are going to appeal again. They said it's Groundhog Day. They're going to keep at it, and I don't know where they're going to take this, but I certainly hope that the precedent set is not $1.5 million suing an individual for inadvertently sharing 24 songs, because that just seems quite frankly monstrous, just like that one judge said. Paul, thank you for the call. Okay, let's go to this next caller in New York. Hi, who's this? Hello, New York caller. Are you there?
Hey, Eric.
Hi, who's this?
This is Constantine from New York.
Hi, Constantine, and what's your comment? And I warn people.
Well, I just wanted to.
Let me say, I see Leo's Mustang pulling up, so this will probably be the last call. Thanks, everybody, for calling in, but we'll stop taking new calls for right now. So, Constantine, go ahead. What's your comment?
It's just a quick comment. It's an observation about maybe what Steve Jobs is doing, and that's kind of driving the consumerization of the Mac computers. And you hear people calling in, and oftentimes they're even technical people, and they're thinking of making their primary machine, the MacBook Air. And I just wanted to put the thought out there that if you're a technical person, you're doing design and programming or even video editing, then we should stick to the more powerful computers and use the MacBook Air more like the iPad. And that's it.
Yeah, I think you're saying that was your comment. Well, thanks. Appreciate the call. And I agree with you, because I think what we're seeing is a bifurcation in computing needs. I think more and more people are more and more satisfied with a lighter weight computer that does that doesn't require much CPU. And I mean, if you can do basic web browsing, basic photo editing, photo tagging your iPhotos and so forth, your basic video editing, and just sync that stuff up to the cloud, never have to worry about backing it up locally or any of that stuff, I think that is starting to satisfy a lot of people and will satisfy more. And I think the comparatively niche market of people who need very high performance computing, like professionals who need high power rendering, and you know, the folks who also just gamers as a hobby, I think we're seeing that the market is moving towards the people who are more the mass, who are satisfied with something like a MacBook Air, something that is lightweight and well, in performance as well as literally. Let's see. This next caller is from Tampa. Hi, who's this?
This is Fred.
Hi, Fred. What's your comment?
Which MacBook Air or which Air did you buy? Is that 128 gigabytes?
I went with the 256. I maxed it out, thinking that this could be a this could become my main machine, and could last into the future. As a machine for the next, you know, 2 years or so, that could serve as a main machine for all sorts of things.
So you can change the memory on those things? If I were to buy a 64 gigabyte, can you up it or down it?
No,
or,
no. What you pick is what you get forever on the MacBook Airs. You cannot upgrade it. So make that decision carefully with the RAM, the CPU, and including the storage, because it's soldered right on. Actually, you can kind of upgrade the storage, but it's not. It'll certainly void your warranty, and it's non-trivial. And the upgrades that have been announced haven't actually come out yet from Japan.
What's the difference in feeling wise between the 11 and the 13 inch?
It's less than a pound, and it's a significant difference in height, I would say. The 11 inch just feels a lot shorter, a lot smaller. You could fit that sort of in a jacket pocket, in a big pocket, but not quite so with the 13 inch, although it's still extremely thin. But it's not ultra portable in the way that you could just have it like walking down the street, like in your pocket, that you could with the 11 inch. But you know, you get more screen real estate, so you can do more and different computing with it.
Okay, well, I didn't want to take long, but I wanted your opinion. I love your show.
Great, thank you so much. And I'm here. I'm getting the word from Jammer B that that Leo is ready. So. Fred,
okay.
Thanks for the call, and I'm gonna say goodbye here. Let's see, queuing up this awesome theme from Dan Lueders here. So this has been Tech Talk Back. My name is Erik Lanigan. I do this show every Thursday from 9 a.m. to 11 a.m. Pacific, which is 12 p.m. to 2 p.m. Eastern. You can follow me on Twitter at Erik Lanigan, E-R-I-K-L-A-N-I-G-A-N, to see what I'm up to and to write back and see what you think about this show and what you'd like to talk about for next week. Tech TalkBack, of course, is the show where you guys get to call in, voice your opinions on the latest tech news, the latest tech gadgets, and hopefully soon we'll have some more things to talk about as more and more tablets come out and other things come out. So see you next week. Erik Lanigan on Twitter. Bye-bye. Thanks again to Dan Lueders for that awesome, awesome theme song. All right, everybody, I'll see you next week. Time for Windows Weekly now. Leo will be in momentarily. Sorry, it's a little anticlimactic to then just sit here after that theme song. I apologize. It's like, yay, great ending, and then he's still here. Losing out of TalkShoe. Signing out of various things. Windows Weekly? Okay. What else is around here? Oh, I can put away my Air, my MacBook Air. I apologize that it just seems like, okay, it's just dead now. This show is done. And we're between shows. I post the audio. No, I post the video and also hopefully soon the audio for Tech Talk Back on ericlanigan.com. It's also on odtv.me. We're getting some good links in the chat room right now for some training. Oh, totaltraining.com is another good one for Final Cut Pro training and other professional apps. A callback to when I said that I think the best way to learn professional apps like that is through video tutorials. I have no idea when that thing showed up, the scroller. It was here when I got in. Thanks, everybody. If you have any suggestions for what to do next time on Tech Talk Back or some ideas going on throughout the week for stories and you say, hey, can't wait to talk about this, why don't you tweet me at Erik Lanigan, E-R-I-K, L-A-N-I-G-A-N, and I'll also respond, hopefully, and then make it a point to discuss that. So thanks, everyone. Next week. Bye-bye. Time for Windows Weekly.
Files. Awesome. That's awesome. What was the website, may I, if I may ask?
It was a website for a publication in the UK called Music
to Work. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Paywall?
Paywall.
Interesting. They've had some good results. The Times had some decent results, I think.
Yeah, they announced the results earlier on this week.
I saw that, yeah.
It was better than thought.
Yeah. Now, News of the World is the one with the naked girls, right? No.
No, that's the Sun.
That's the Sun, okay.
That's the next
Hey, look. It's working. So what Twitter account is this that it's following? Did he already screw it down?
Oh, good. It's got to stand. Because I think I want to move it over a little bit.
Yeah, if you're blocking, you can't really read it.
Right.
Yeah. It's got like
but it can't.
It's like repeating the same two or three tweets over and over again.
Yeah, because it's tied to an account, a bogus account.
Wrong person.
So we need to tie it to Twitter. But I think
they always control.
Yeah.
Right.
There's
yours.
Was standing up. I somehow screwed it up. I guess it wasn't standing up that firmly. Yeah, I think when we want to screw it down, I think I want to screw it down a little bit more to the right. Because my head is blocking it. That is awesome. How about the speed on that? You like the speed on that, chat room? So that's our twist splay. It's not a sliding rail. It's actually just kind of sitting there, but we do have rails. Oh, delicious. Thank you so much. Oh, my God. Oh. God, is that good. God, that's good. Hello, everybody. Welcome to This Week in What Leo's Drinking. Today, I'm drinking a fine... Wow, am I not hearing my ding-dong? I don't hear my ding-dong, my ding-dong day. Paul.
Listen, we have an emergency situation here today.
You got your Kinect.
And my kids are going to be home in about 45 minutes.
Let me tell they're going to say, Daddy.
Let me explain to you the note that's on the front of the TV. It says, please do not use the Kinect until I'm done. And let me explain to you.